One of the things that we are investing heavily in is in data technology, and especially within that data technology, not only large computers and nice databases and artificial intelligence, but also in the data management about it. Another thing where we're investing a lot is if you have that data, it will be never complete. You have to take 100% decisions with incomplete databases.
Correct.
And that means that you need to train your people to be able to deal with uncertainty and ambiguity. Mm-hmm. That's a skill set that in my time when I went to the university that people did not learn. I see younger people coming from university now into my company who has the ability to handle that in a far smarter way than I learned. So I think it is not only about technology, it's also about developing a talent pool of people who are able to handle uncertainty and ambiguity.
Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. We are now starting our season 3, and I'm delighted to welcome our first guest of season 3, Mr. Jeroen, both from the Netherlands. Jeroen, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Ish. I'm honored.
Thank you. Jeroen is the Chief Supply Chain Officer of the Axcel Group, the Netherlands. He was earlier with the British American Tobacco, or BAT Industries, for over 2 decades. So, Jeroen, tell me a little bit about what is the scope of work Axcel Group handles?
Axcel is a European-based company. We are a bicycle company, and we are the market leader in Europe for mainly also electrical bikes, e-bikes. We have a number of brands, both Dutch brands like Batavia, Sparta, and Koga, but also a number of German, French brands. And we make actually any type of bicycle you can think of that goes from children's bikes, also bikes for the Olympics. And nowadays we also make bikes for cargo to solve mobility problems, for instance, in the cities. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, any bike we can make. We are focusing on the premium and the high premium markets. And since 2006, when the electrical bike was introduced by Axcel in Europe, we see more and more electrification in our portfolio. Right. But the main markets are European markets. Mm-hmm. We source our product all over the world, mainly from Asia. So as the chief supply chain, I have to travel in Asia also a lot. Pre-corona times, I spent 30-40% of my time in Asia. Mm-hmm. And we do all our assembly ourselves. We have 4 big assembly plants in Europe, one in Turkey as well. And then we have a couple of smaller assembly plants. Components we don't make ourselves, we buy them. And that is basically the scope. So I'm responsible as a member of the board for supply chain procurement, manufacturing, product development, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah.
Fabulous. So, you know, this is a special series of interviews I'm doing on the supply chain.
Yeah.
And thank you for, being a part of this. For a long time, I have assumed, you know, I believe that the supply chain, which is so critical to the functioning of every organization, has not been getting the incredible amount of importance it deserves. So I'm going to focus our conversation today only on the supply chain. My first question to you is that what has changed in the environment that is making companies rethink their supply chains?
Yeah, I think in the, especially if you look in my sector, is the impact that supply chain has on the total company. Is huge. About 80% of the components, of the 80% of the cost price we buy in components. Mm-hmm. So if you have a company of let's say 1.2 billion euro of turnover, round and about 800 or 900 million is actually spent on procurement, assembly, and logistics. Mm-hmm. So the impact and the strategic importance of supply chain, especially of this kind of companies, is extremely high. Mm-hmm. Another key driver is, of course, from a consumer-centric thought, the service that you have to deliver, different delivery channels, the digitalization, the speed of things is another important driver. And last but not least, Ash, and I'm sure we're going to talk about it as well, mm-hmm. The number of disruption in the last decades or so, and don't think only about COVID, think yep. also about trade wars, about bad weather situation. Think about in Europe, especially also the UK leaving the EU, Brexit. These all events has significant disruptions and impact on supply chain, and therefore also on the total P&L and balance sheet of the company.
Very true. Very true. Yeah. So, in the immediate term, most businesses have been severely affected by the pandemic.
Yeah.
What is your view on the impact on the supply chains?
Yeah, for us, it was huge. As I said before, most of the components that we buy, like frames, like tires, chains, and you name it, mm-hmm. are sourced all over the world, mainly from Asia. Mm-hmm. Think about countries like Taiwan, but also Malaysia, Singapore, China, etc. And what we have noticed, let's go back in time a little bit. This time last year, when COVID hit for the first time the Asian countries, the component supplies from Asia to Europe were heavily affected.
Correct.
And then in February, March, COVID traveled to Europe. It hit the European markets. And also, actually, shops were closed, economies came to a halt, etc. And then you actually discover how vulnerable your supply chain is. Long lead times, and the longer the lead time is, the higher the chance of deviations. Mm. So I think one of the things that needs to change fundamentally thinking in supply chain models is, I'm an old geezer as well. I was raised also in terms of thinking of KPIs, of efficiency, cost reduction, etc. But the risk thinking and how you mitigate against risk and make the supply chain more resilient so that we can still deliver the goods and the finished product on time and full to the consumer, taking on board that things can go wrong and have that risk mindset instead of only being focused on cost efficiency and cash. I think, that is something that we learned the last decade, but especially during the last 1.5 years, it became a topic very much on board levels of companies like Accel as well. Yeah,
interesting. So you are your own handling the supply chain for a product, finished product that has very large number of small parts.
Yes,
and
correct.
You just mentioned that you are, you've been traveling extensively all over Asia.
Yeah,
for your procurement, etc. Over the years, and when I was growing up, and talking of 4 decades ago. We used to have a chief accountant, a personnel manager, and a purchase manager. And they have now been evolved into the chief financial officer, the chief supply chain officer, and the chief human resource officer.
Yeah,
want to understand from you, for all our viewers and listeners, how has the supply chain function evolved and how are you using technology?
Yeah, that's a very good question. First of all, Accel is an international company, but I always say we are actually a group of mid-sized and smaller companies, and that gives us a certain agility. And it is only 4 or 5 years ago when we started actually to make use of our scale and actually align the processes so that we are had one facing to the supplier. Mm-hmm. What is extremely important for us is actually visibility. And that you see also in terms of crisis management, in terms of COVID, but also in the trade wars. We need to understand not only what is happening on our supply partners, mm-hmm. but what is happening also on the tier 2, the tier 3, and the tier 4 suppliers. And to get that visibility without exploding your overhead, technology, data management plays extremely important role. Mm. That means being able to track and trace your orders, both from the backside of the supply chain as on the front side of the supply chain is important, but also making sure that you think in scenarios. Yeah, and the way I was raised, making a plan, making a budget, you did that once per year, and then every quarter you did a forecast review, and that was basically it.
Correct.
I think in this VUCA world, where volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity is a fact of daily life, thinking in scenarios and making sure that you are agile and that you have that transparency of data is very important. You can do that manually and try to do that in a spreadsheet and by calling people and visiting people, but then you need a overhead that will be massive and exploding. So one of the things that we are investing heavily in is in data technology, and especially within that data technology, not only large computers and nice databases and artificial intelligence, but also in the data management about it. Another thing where we're investing a lot is if you have that data, it will be never complete. You have to take 100% decisions with incomplete databases.
Correct.
And that means that you need to train your people to be able to deal with uncertainty and ambiguity. Mm-hmm. That's a skill set that in my time when I went to the university that people did not learn. I see younger people coming from university now into my company who has the ability to handle that in a far smarter way than I learned. So I think it is not only about technology, it's also about developing a talent pool of people who are able to handle uncertainty and ambiguity. Yeah.
Interesting. And, I've often been reading. I'm not an expert in the supply chain business, but I've been reading and I've been talking to other people. They say that the supply chain will be an automatic recipient of artificial intelligence technologies, machine learning, robotics, drones. What are your thoughts?
It is happening. It is happening. What I don't know to which extent that will go. Mm-hmm. I must say that the human factor is still extremely important. I give you one example where we apply artificial intelligence. We are currently running a data program within Accel. Mm-hmm. And one of the problems that we had is that the same component was described in many ways. I think this is a problem that many companies has. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, this pen, for instance, mm-hmm. It could be an X of a front wheel or something, mm-hmm. and that same X in the different plans that we have, in the different regions that we have, was described with different codes and different descriptors, etc. Mm-hmm. So one thing that we actually did, Ash, we actually, in the old days, we would hire people that then would harmonize their data. Mm-hmm. And what we currently have is an IE program, an artificial program, that we tell, this is the pen that we want to describe. These are the dimensions. These are the characteristics. Mm-hmm. And that program learns from that and detects where that pen is applied in our products. And then adjusted the data according to the standards that we want. Mm-hmm. And because the artificial element in that is, that from that exercise it learns. So if you then do the next component and the next component, it go faster and more precise than we could have done in a manual way. So this is one small example that is happening. On robotics, we see more and more manual processes. You know, welding a frame is hard labor. It's very hot. It is also dangerous work. And we see robots introduced in the process, not so much replacing people, but helping people in that production process. Another example which I think interested you, in many assembly processes, you need to screw a lot of things together. You have that in the car industry as well. Mm-hmm. Maybe you have seen it on television, but nowadays you have people that can wear a robotic hand that can help them actually assemble components to each other.
Wow. Okay.
So, yeah, I think the human factor is still superior, because the human factor can always detect deviations faster and better than robots and artificial intelligence can. So it is about this symbiose, this combination of these new technologies and the human element, how you can actually use it. It's not something to get spooky about. It's something that you know, we need to see that as a tool that in a smart way we can apply that.
Absolutely. Fantastic.
Yeah.
So now let's look at from the perspective of the customer.
Yeah.
The supply chain is as important for delivery to the customer. Over the last few years, and more so in the pandemic, the customer has got used to home delivery of most products. And home delivery within 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Do you think that this is going to change the paradigm of the supply chain forever?
Yes and no. It will, but maybe not in the way you're expecting. So this whole paradigm of supply chain is all about process synchronization and collaboration.
Right.
In that sense, it will not change, but the dynamics will. Take a customer for a bicycle.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a bicycle is not a food product that needs to be delivered in 30 minutes. That will never happen.
Absolutely.
But if you look at the whole consumer journey, it always starts on the internet, that people want to select a bike and then starts to compare. And they start to realize where they want to use the bike for. Is it commuting? Is it sports activity? Is it leisure? Et cetera, et cetera. In the end of the day, they still want to go to an experience center to ride the bike themselves. You can't do that digitally. So the digital development will change that that journey of the customer. The consumer are far better informed. But they still want to have somebody to talk to, go to a dealer or an experience center to do some test riding and get the confirmation what they found digital on the internet. And this makes things very interesting, because now you get a digital world and a physical world that needs to be married. I still believe in the bicycle world, we will need dealers, but that role will change. The underlying processes of collaboration, services that you have to deliver, and the synchronization between all those processes, that part, Ash, will remain the same. But in a sense, it will become easier.
Okay. Yeah? And just as a follow-up on that, you know, I think work from home
is
becoming almost a part of normal life now. And even when the lockdowns are lifted, which I hope happens soon, work from home will become a part of our daily operations. How do you think working from home and the fact that, you know, there's a lot of distributed engagement that will take place within the corporate world, how will that impact supply chains?
Well, we are not a really big corporate kind of company. You know, we have 3,500 people in total with a management layer, I think, of around and about 150, 200 people. Factories across all Europe, partners in Asia, and distributed all over the world. So we were basically already used to work a lot of digital. What I do see change is that prior to Corona, and I actually had a look at the network usage that we did. Let's say that was around and about 60%. If I now compare it with Corona or post-Corona even, it's close to 80-90%. So I think we will go to a hybrid model where working not in the office but from a location, either when you travel or at home, will become more and more and more. And the office becomes much more of a meeting center for workshops, for team meetings, but not anymore a place where you do in a routine way your work. Because if you have, like we are now talking, you are being in India and I'm in the Netherlands, we still can connect each other. We can have this interview. And that is what we do with our partners as well. It's very convenient. It saves time. And I think Corona forced us to learn that doing that faster. And I will think also in Europe, we will see that balance between working at home and occasionally going to a meeting center. I think that will be the balance.
Fascinating.
So that means that we have to redesign our offices.
Right. So I've got one more question for you. And, you know, and I'm going to now go back into history, so to speak. When I was growing up, you know, I was an accountant and I'm sure you were a purchase manager. But today, the chief supply chain officer has become a member of the C-suite, part of the board. Yeah. What, in your opinion, has changed and what has evolved in the role of the purchase manager or the chief supply chain officer?
Yeah, I can remember, Ash, when I started my career, the word supply chain did not even exist. It was all about purchase and logistics. And I think what I've seen over time, that role has gained in strategic importance, for sure. Nowadays, a company is like an ecosystem. If I look how we do product innovation, of course, we have a research and development department and we have factories and this, that, and the other. Mm. But it's all about connecting with partners. Mm. And for most of the breakthrough innovations, also in the bike industry, it does not come from the industry itself. It comes from the outside industry. The electrical bike is an example of that. Mm. The first electrical bike was a steel bike with an engine of a domestic appliance from a lawnmower. And that is how that innovation started. So I think companies will become more and more an ecosystem. I think the Japanese even have a term for it. They call it a karitsu, where you have a company in the center with all kinds of smaller and bigger companies around, and they work together. Not necessarily owning equity in each other, or big and complex contracts. They are actually working in a network, doing innovation, doing business.
Very interesting. Jeroen, thank you so much. It has been such a pleasure speaking to you. I mean, thank you for the incredible knowledge you have shared with me on supply chains. And, you know, you're on welcome. Behalf of all our viewers and listeners, I mean, I think there's so much new things they will learn from our conversation. Thank you again and good luck.
Thank you very much. It has been a great honor to participate in your show. Thanks for the interview.
Thank you.
Supply Chain Labs was founded in 2019 by investment firm Loomis Partners to identify, collaborate, and invest in 50 of the best supply chain startups over a 5-year discovery period. Supply chain is one of the most core areas for any segment of the economy, and even more so in a large and growing country like India, which needs deep innovation to help bridge the gaps in the physical supply chain, currently amplified even more so with COVID. In a short time frame of 2 years, Supply Chain Labs is already known as India's first and most widely recognized supply chain focused fund and fellowship.
Thank you for listening to the brand called You Videocast and Podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website www.tbcy.in to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for the brand called You.